things of earth are dimming in the light of your glory and grace. I'll set the sights upon heaven. I'm fixing my eyes on you.
Good morning, guys. Welcome to church. We're the youth band singers, and we're going to bring you a new song. If you'd like to stand and sing with us, please feel free.
I'll praise in the valley, praise on the mountain. I'll praise when I'm sure, praise when I'm happy. I'll praise when I'm comforted, praise when surrounded. Cause praise is the water, my enemy's drowning.
To do some actions for this next song. Good job, Leo.
Isn't it great to have our kids and our young people involved this morning? Kids, don't go too far away. I'm going to get you to sit down the front here. We've got something very special coming up for you now. And if you'd like to take a seat, we've got a very special Easter presentation for you. I'll just give these guys a second to get themselves ready. All right, we're looking forward to this.
What are you doing, Pirate, eh?
Ahoy, me mateys. I found me here this treasure map for the greatest treasure of all time. And I've been looking for the bounty everywhere. It came to my attention that I'm going to need a bigger boat to carry all the treasure. Arr!
Yeah, you're right. You're going to need a bigger boat.
Oh, seriously, Will, you had a single line and that's the best you could do?
Why did you wreck that?
Arr, me hearties, I really gotta get me a bigger boat. So you see me problem here, Fisherman Ed?
Maybe, but where do you think the treasure is? Give me a look at that map. If you turn the map this way, it looks like the treasure's located on land, so you don't need a boat at all.
Shiver me timbers, you old sea dog, but I'm a pirate. What do you mean I don't need a boat? I know the land, lubber. You might think us pirates like the letter R, but it's the sea that us pirates love. And really bad dad jokes.
Well, the cross that you're looking for here is the cross of Jesus. Jesus is what you're looking for. Find the cross and you'll discover the greatest treasure of all time.
Blow me down. So you mean I'm not looking for an X, but more of a T? A wooden land-based T? Which, if I find then, the treasure, the beauty will be all mine.
That's right. It really is the greatest treasure of all time. And you don't need a boat at all to find it. In the Bible, it says in 1 Corinthians 1 verse 18, "For the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is the power of God." Find the cross, Pirate A, and you will find the power of God.
Yeah, I don't care what anyone else thinks. I'm finding me that treasure. Who's with me, lads? Fair winds, Fisherman Ed.
Well, thank you for that, guys. The exciting news is they will be back over the next few weeks. We are having these guys stick around throughout our school holidays and Easter period, so make sure you come each week and you can check out what Pirate A gets up to. Maybe next week you'll get a full name. We'll see. More than just a letter. But it is lovely to be here in church with you this morning. My name's Scotty. I'm one of the pastors here. And it is lovely to have you here worshiping with us as we celebrate Palm Sunday. Just stick it on the ground. It'll be all right. It's lovely to be here together. How fun is it to be able to see our young people up the front leading us in worship and all the different activities that we get to see? It's pretty cool, hey? It is one of the things that I truly love so much about this church as a parent is just all the different levels of things that I know our wonderful volunteers do for our young kids, right through from really little, as you'll see some hanging on the stage earlier and hanging out with some of their leaders that they love, right through to our teenagers who get to learn how to lead worship and lead things out the back and do apologetics and all of those things. So a big thank you to all of our volunteers who go out. I know you guys have been working really hard this term. So yeah, let's give them a round of applause. Thank you so much, guys. You guys do a wonderful job. And as parents and as families, we greatly, greatly appreciate you. Coming to this church, that's been one of the best things as a parent to just go, oh, I'm just so happy to be here as a parent, let alone as a pastor and as a person. So, yeah, we're really excited. Now, who can tell me, kids, what's on after church today? Eloise. A church picnic. Where's it at? At Alexandra Park. And when is it? Yeah, that was a trick question. We don't have an exact time. It's just after church. So after church, we are heading over to Alexandra Park. Grab yourself some takeaway, or if you've already prepared in advance, then good job. We're going to head over there. We'll play some cricket. We'll share some food and some fellowship and some fun. So make sure you come along there. If you don't know where Alexandra Park is, Google is your friend. If not, go ask Pastor Richard. He'll tell you how to get there. But make sure you come along to that. It will be absolutely great fun. And make sure over the next couple of weeks, we'd love to see you coming along to the rest of our Easter services on Thursday night this coming week. We have our upper room service. I believe that's at 6 p.m. Am I correct in saying that? 7 p.m. Thank you, Belinda. 7 p.m. here at the church on Thursday night. If you haven't been to our upper room service, it is a lovely, somber, reflective service, reflecting on the time leading up to the crucifixion. And then 9 a.m. Friday morning on Good Friday, we'll have our Good Friday service. And then Easter Sunday, if you want to join us again at 9 a.m. and at 6 p.m. for our Easter services. It will be a great time to share together. But again, we'll be continuing our More Than Enough series right through the holidays, again with our Pirates too. So make sure you join us and come along for that. And the last other thing that I need to announce, which I didn't actually remember the date, so someone's going to help me out with this, but we have a special members meeting coming up in 3 weeks. Is it the 14th, Richard? It's the 14th of April, and we'll be discussing a motion that is coming up at the QB, is it members meeting? What do you call it? The QB assembly, that's the word I was looking for, down on the Gold Coast as part of the QB conference that's coming up. They are putting forward a motion allowing churches to ordain women as ordained pastors individually, and so we're going to be discussing what that looks like, and people can ask questions and all of that sort of stuff. So if you want to come and be a part of that conversation and just hear what's going on in our wider movement and how we are dealing with that and how we are engaging with that, please come along after church on Sunday, the 14th of April, and you'll hear more about that. All right, kids, you guys get to go out and enjoy your time. And as the kids head out, I want to encourage you to jump up for a couple of minutes and turn to someone near to you, say g'day, feel free to go for a bit of a wander around as our kids go out and make each other feel welcome. Thanks, guys.
All right. Okay. great to hear all the conversations that are happening, and you can continue those after the service over a cuppa or at the picnic if you want an even longer conversation. Okay, we are going to continue worshipping together this morning, and I just want to read a couple of verses. Today is, of course, Palm Sunday, and in case you hadn't noticed with all the decorations. So these verses come from the book of John. The next day, the crowd that had come for the festival heard that Jesus was on his way to Jerusalem. They took palm branches and went out to meet him, shouting, "Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the King of Israel." We're going to stand together now and sing praises to our King.
Crown him with many crowns.
Hark now the heavenly anthem drown. Oh, music by
Rob Avery is going to lead us now in prayer.
I have to say, how great was it seeing all those kids up the front here? Let's just pray. I'll just read out Lamentations 3. It says, because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Let us pray. Our Father, we come before you today and acknowledge that you are our Lord and our God. Thank you that you are for your great love for us and for the mercy and compassion that you faithfully show us each day. Thank you for making us and for your daily provision for us. Thank you that despite our sin and rebellion against you, you took our sins and nailed them to the cross. Thank you, Lord, for Jesus, who humbly lived a perfect life and died the death that we deserve so that we can be forgiven. Thank you for raising Jesus from the dead to new life, and in the same way, one day, we will be raised to be with you for all eternity. I pray, Lord, this Easter we would be the people that you created us to be, and despite our faults, that Jesus would shine through us to those all around us. Lord, I want to bring before you the needs of this church. I just want to pray for those who are sick or failing in their health. Thank you, Lord, that you are the great healer, that you are able to provide comfort and healing to those in suffering. Lord, may you intervene for those in pain, and please help people also obtain necessary medical treatments and advice. I pray, Lord, for those people involved in difficult personal or family relationships. Lord, please provide guidance and understanding in all circumstances as they navigate the struggles of this life. I pray, Lord, for the genuine healing of bad relationships as we are called to forgive each other just as we are forgiven. Lord, I just want to pray for those struggling with financial pressures or people trying to find a job or people really doing it tough. Lord, the rise of cost of living has not made it easy. Making ends meet each day can be very, very challenging. And I want to thank you that you are a God who is in control and that you are able to provide in all circumstances. Lord, I also want to pray for those struggling with addictions of any kind. It could be alcohol, it could be technology, gambling or pornography. Lord, I pray that by the power of your Holy Spirit that you would release these people from their bondage and direct them in ways to deal with these difficulties. I just want to pray about the various ministries of this church. Lord, thank you for those who contribute to the various ministries. Thank you for those in the congregation who each week generously give their time and their money to the church. And we pray that you'd bless the finances of this church and provide godly wisdom to those in leadership. I just want to pray for the various youth activities at this church, creche and their Sunday school, jump and youth group. Thank you, Lord, that last weekend there were over 200 young people in our community that attended these groups and who are developing in their faith. And many of these young people aren't even from this church. They're from maybe non-Christian families. So, Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would sustain the leaders in each of these groups and provide ways that the gospel can be clearly proclaimed this Easter. Just want to pray for various discipleship groups as well, such as home groups, apologetics, there's coach community mentoring, and Alpha. Thank you, Lord, for the growth of each of these ministries. We just pray for your blessing as the gospel is lived out in people's lives. Please direct the leaders of these groups so they can effectively serve you and disciple those around you. Lord, we've had some break-ins recently. I just want to pray for your protection upon each individual in this church and for wisdom to know how to stop break-ins as well. Just want to pray for the pastoral team and for the elders. May you give them help and guide them each day and their families. May you give them wisdom and direction of how they can best serve you in this church. As we approach Easter, I just want to pray for Christians across the world. Thank you for various missionary organisations that are involved in proclaiming the scriptures and translating the scriptures and reaching out to a lost world. May you raise up leaders to go into all the corners of the world and proclaim the good news about Christ. Please watch over our brothers and sisters in Christ who are suffering persecution and hardship for the Christian faith. May they learn to trust in you and wait for your deliverance. Lord God, you know all our needs and you understand each of our situations. So we bring these before you now and ask for your guidance for each one of us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
This morning's reading comes from Romans 8, 35 to 39. Can anything ever separate us from Christ's love? Does it mean he no longer loves us if we have trouble or calamity, or are persecuted, or are hungry, or destitute, or in danger, or threatened with death? As the scriptures say, for your sake we are killed every day. We are being slaughtered like sheep. No, despite all these things, overwhelming victory is ours through Christ, who loved us. And I am convinced that nothing can ever separate us from God's love. Neither death nor life, neither angels or demons, neither our fears for today, nor our worries about tomorrow, not even the powers of hell can separate us from God's love. No power in the sky above or in the earth below, indeed, nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God that is revealed in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Sorry about the different translation up on the screen. That's my fault. This morning, I just wanted to give you some good news, everyone. Last Sunday, we were talking about our need for leaders, and in the evening service, Adele got up and she said, last weekend, she'd done the count, 207 kids came to be involved with our church last weekend. One weekend. Kids or parents of playtime families were included. And 102 of those were people that are not normally regular attenders of our church. All right? So that was very eye-opening. It shows how many people we are serving and the opportunity that we've got. And I want to share that news so that you will keep praying for the church, keep praying for those ministries, that we will do a terrific job of looking after every family that comes on Friday mornings, where they're almost exclusively from the community rather than from church. Where at our Friday night jump program for primary school age kids, the more than about two-thirds of the families and children represented are from the community, and also in our youth group it's about 50-50, okay? So, we have an outreach ministry happening right now already with the things that we are doing, and we just want really to get God's guidance on how to do it fantastically well. So please pray about that. And also, just want to say, on top of what Rob prayed, thank you to the church. We need to recognise that financially, the church is doing well at the moment by God's grace. Our church budget is being met and we're able to expand the things that we are doing. And I just want to say thank you and acknowledge that, because we don't talk about the offering. You don't see the bags getting handed around anymore. There's not that kind of physical reminder, but it's so important. And so just want to acknowledge thank you. This next weekend, we, as always, have a special offering set aside at Easter time that doesn't go to church. It goes outside of church to Crossover Australia, which is the Baptist Ministries Australia outreach ministry. And so I know most people give electronically. If you would like some of your offering or all of your offering, whatever, to go to Crossover Australia this Easter time, please take note of the details in the newsletter, and then that money can go outside of the church to the mission around the rest of the country. All right. So, Palm Sunday. It's kind of like Jesus was a rock star or some celebrity, like he got the red carpet treatment because the people were very excited. They all rolled up. They all wanted to see this person. And they laid the palm branches and even their cloaks down on the road like a red carpet. And we celebrate all around the world the event of Palm Sunday. But we need to recognize when those people were gathered there and they're shouting out, "Hosanna, Hosanna," they had a particular agenda in mind. And we get the sense of exactly what their agenda was, because Hosanna literally means save. Save now. Please save us. And then we get even more of the gist of what was going on when we hear the rest of the things they were calling out. Blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. These people weren't there just to meet a rock star or a celebrity. They were gathering around Jesus, hoping that he might be the answer, the one who was going to get rid of the rotten Romans, the king to replace Rome with the new kingdom of God in Israel. That's why they're so energized. They had an expectancy, they had a need. The Roman Empire was terrible to live under. They put people up on crosses routinely as a public demonstration. Don't mess with us. This is what happens if you try to resist. They'd put the crosses right next to public thoroughfares and leave people hanging there with rotten things coming out of their bodies and rotting away, because it was a public signpost, a huge poster. Don't mess with Rome. So I guess if we were living under that type of terrifying situation, we might have some of the same hopes and the same longings, a desire for regime change, just like they did. Today, we're continuing in our More Than Enough series, and we're talking about how Jesus is more than enough for the troubles of our world. And that's a big call. It's kind of like taking Christianity's worst problem, suffering, and trying to turn it around and talk about how Jesus is more than enough for all of that. So you're going to have to bear with me this morning as we look at this. And I remain to see whether you're convinced at the end or not. If you've got better ideas after this sermon, come and talk to me. I want to learn more in this space. I believe it. Jesus is more than enough for the troubles of this world. But exactly how to put that into words today is not exactly easy. I think we're looking for solutions to exactly the same problems as the people along the road into Jerusalem that day. We're looking for solutions to the problem of our troubles. Whether we're looking for a government to sort it out, some new political thing, some silver bullet solution, we're looking for answers, solutions to the problems of our lives. How do we find security? How do we find a future for our families and for ourselves? Jesus arrives at the beginning of Passion Week and he is the coming king. He has been sent by God. He is the Messiah. He is God's anointed one. He's come to save the people and give them a secure future, but it's just not like they're expecting. It's not exactly what they want. The agendas don't line up. They're not compatible. And I'd propose to you this morning that if we look back in history, we see that ever since Adam and Eve got kicked out of the garden, humans have pretty much been asking themselves this. How do we find safety? How do we find security? Now, even this morning, if you're one of those people that maybe thinks Adam and Eve are a bit of a myth, just run with this for a minute. Let's say, at a minimum, they are meant to be representative of humanity in the Bible story. When things went wrong right back then in the garden and they committed original sin, and imagine what it was like for them to go from a situation where they knew who they were, what they were there for, how God would provide for them, perfect safety and the amazing convenience of just walking and talking with God every evening. From that scenario, things suddenly go completely wrong and they are tossed out of the garden and nothing is guaranteed anymore. How unsafe, how out of control would that have felt? What about food? What about shelter? How do we relate to God anymore? Even if that's just a representative story, and I believe it's much more than that. What I'm saying to you this morning is I think we can all imagine that struggle, and my suggestion is it's been our struggle ever since. This is a completely human problem. How do we find security for our future? We know for certain that Jesus' disciples were concerned for the future of Israel. Do you remember the very last question that the disciples asked Jesus before he ascended back to heaven? Do you remember what it was? Has the time come for you to free Israel and restore the kingdom of God? Do you see that? They've spent 40 days with Jesus after the resurrection. They've heard him teach about himself now from the scripture and explain how the whole scripture is all about him. What's the question? Not just once, repeatedly they kept asking him this. How do we get our safety and security, Lord? That's what they want to know. I think we can sympathize. This is a very real human need. Where do we find it in our troubled world? The bold claim of Christianity is that Jesus and the cross and the blood of Christ are more than enough. And that's audacious, that Jesus is more than enough. Romans chapter 8, which Suzanne read to us, is like the pinnacle in Romans. It's a bold declaration that security comes through Jesus, that he guarantees. Yeah, I said last week, Romans is like spelling out the contract of grace. That's the one way of describing it. Spelling out the covenant of grace in great detail. And chapter 8 is the pinnacle, of the celebration of the good news. And Paul is so bold as to suggest what Jesus has done on the cross answers our need for security. He declares nothing can take it away. No calamity or famine, no poverty or other cause, no danger, neither death nor life, angels or demons, neither fears of today nor worries about tomorrow. No government, no terrorist plot, no invading army or political power, none of these things matter compared to the love and power of God. Paul is convinced our safety and our security question has been answered because Jesus is more than enough. Now, I guess that already you've looked at that promise and you're saying, that's not a promise that I'll never have any troubles, Richard. That's not what I'm looking for. I want the first class ticket, please. I want the 30,000 feet option. Sipping champagne, nibbling caviar, flying over the top of all the troubles, no pain, please. That's the ticket I'm looking for. And I guess if you know the castle well, you know what the next line is. Tell him he's dreaming. Yeah? The fact is, if I got up here this morning, if anyone got up here this morning and said, I've got the guaranteed pain-free option for you right now, this is the gospel, Jesus promises it, sign up here, please, very rightly, you'd be able to go, I don't believe it. That's fake. That's not real. And it's true because that would be a false gospel. That is not the good news of Jesus Christ, as much as we might want it. No matter who in the world is trying to sell you that, whether they're a new political superstar or a self-help guru or a positive thinking personality leader, whatever. You know, that's a false gospel. It's not the real good news. Jesus promised some amazing things. He promised that God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him might not perish, but have eternal life. This is what he promised. He promised eternal life for every believer. And we know that's his guarantee. He's very clear. But he also says, in this world you will have trouble. We know that too. He says, here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world. I believe that Paul writes what he writes in Romans chapter 8, celebrating the security we can have, fully understanding the troubles of this world. This man went through more calamities and dangers and floggings and imprisonments and being nearly stoned to death, shipwrecks, armed holdups, you name it. He went through the mill. He knows the troubles of the world. He knows the security question. He's not blind to that stuff. But these verses he writes are a promise that God will take us through those things, and that our ultimate need to be in the kingdom of God, in the presence of God, to have eternal life is fulfilled because of the love of God. And when the new heavens and the new earth come, not even eternity can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. That's the high point of Paul's celebration. It's the pinnacle. It's meant to provide us with hope and a confident hope. But moving on from that, Paul's personal experience is not just that one day we get the 30,000 feet option. He's talking about here on earth a terrestrial journey, and he says his personal experience is God's grace is provided. God's grace provides security through suffering, and it's epitomized, I think, by the story of the thorn in his flesh. That's how he describes it. A thorn in his flesh, a messenger from Satan sent to torment him. That doesn't sound nice, does it? That type of language. Last year, our daughter Sarah, who lives in Brisbane, she loves frisbee competitions. She went to a day in a park. It happened to be a big bougainvillea garden park. And some of you already know where this story's going. Sarah didn't know about bougainvilleas. The frisbee went flying into a bush, and she happily just wandered over, reached in, pulled it out, and ooh, got a little scratch. It'll be okay. No. Not so good. Belinda Decker informed me that in her family, the bougainvillea is referred to as the devil's plant. Sarah had this little scratch. Within hours, she could not move her finger. It had blown up and the joint was so inflamed. She ended up on IV antibiotics, and they didn't have to cut anything out because there wasn't actually even anything in there. It was just a scratch. But I think I hear when Paul says he's got a thorn in his flesh and it stays there, he's talking about something really nasty. He tells us he prayerfully asked God to remove it. He begged Jesus to remove the thorn in his flesh. But the answer wasn't, sure, Paul, I'll deal with it ASAP. I'll just whip it out and it's no problems for you. No. Paul records that each time he asked, he got the same message back from the Lord Jesus. My grace is sufficient for you. It's all you need. My power is perfected. It works best in weakness. I'm not sure whether he liked that answer. Times one, times two, times three. But I think we can learn some things here. The first word in the sentence that Jesus gives him is the word sufficient. In our English language, that kind of sounds like barely enough. Because it's the first word that Jesus says, it's meant to come with emphasis. He's saying entirely sufficient, completely enough, very close to more than enough. My grace is entirely sufficient for you. And he's also, I think, important for us to realize, Jesus, God isn't a masochist. This verse is not saying God's enjoying putting Paul through this. The correct sense of this interaction is that God is saying, Paul, you don't really need me to remove the thorn. You don't really need me to take away the source of your suffering. All you need is my grace to deal with it. That's what you really need, and I give you more than enough. I think this episode in Paul's own life helps us to understand the celebration of Romans 8. It is exuberant, it is joyful, it is confident in the cross. But it's not saying God takes it all away, all the difficulty away. Rather, he's saying we are conquerors through Christ who loved us. We have complete victory and overwhelming victory through Jesus Christ. Jesus promises us he will never leave us or forsake us. This is part of the sufficiency of his grace. And when we got kicked out of Eden, there was this difficulty engaging with God. But because of the cross, that's not our problem anymore. We've got the power of God. We've got the presence of God, the Holy Spirit in us. He is with us. He is more than sufficient. And the promise is that he will shower us with comfort so that we have more than enough comfort, not just for ourselves, but also enough comfort to overflow to other people. This is what 2 Corinthians talks about. I'm going to read these words from the beginning of 2 Corinthians. God is our merciful Father and the source of all comfort. He comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort others. For when we're troubled, we will be able to give the same comfort God has given us. For the more we suffer for Christ, the more God will shower us, abound to us, overflow to us with his comfort through Jesus. Verse 5 is about superabundance. It's about more than enough. The New English Translation puts it this way: for just as the sufferings of Christ overflow towards us, so also our comfort through Christ can overflow to others. So here's the question. Think in specific individual terms. Who are the people you know? Some of them who are sitting perhaps even in this congregation right now, people who have shown you an amazing ability to overflow with comfort, to help you, even when you know very well that they themselves are struggling and in pain. They are suffering, and yet somehow they overflow with comfort. I can name names. I'll speak of Nev Maltby. Some of you don't know him, but Nev had chronic leukemia and he spent 12 months of his life waiting, believing that his time was coming in a nursing home, and every time I went to see Neville, he left me feeling blessed. He's a hero in my mind. Does that mean he never complained? No. Does that mean he never asked God to take it away? No. But what I'm saying to you is I know someone, and you know some people, who demonstrate the truth of this. I went round the congregation beforehand asking some people I know who have really struggled and suffered in recent times, trying to get some gems for them, last little bits to add in here to maybe help. Cole Turner said to me, I'm not struggling, I'm not that worried, I know I've got the new body in heaven. Holding on to his eternal hope. I talked to Ian Watson. He said to me, in the end, Richard, you look everywhere else and you find there is no other answer. When you've been through as much as Ian has been through, and he looks you in the eye and he says, it's the answer because it's the only answer. We're learning things, aren't we? So let's summarize. Our safety and security needs are fundamental to being human. Just like the crowds on Palm Sunday, we can have one idea of what we want and need, and Jesus can have a different idea. But he does promise eternal life. He does promise to be with us through all our troubles, in present with us. And even though we want it all to be taken away, and sometimes, folks, God does that. Let's be honest. Sometimes he does just take it all away. But not always. Often, he gives us his victory by the grace of his comfort and the strength to endure. His grace is entirely sufficient, the scripture says. And the good news is, he can actually give us more than enough of his love and his grace so that we can even overflow to others. In our times of struggle, we can still overflow with more than enough to help others. Jesus is the epitome of all of this. He is the model. He is the ultimate example. He was himself not exempt from suffering. He was not whisked away and rescued from the cross. His pathway was in obedience to God's will through trial and pain to victory. The glory that we know Jesus has in the kingdom of heaven came through the valley. But God's superabundance was entirely sufficient for him. Entirely sufficient to resurrect him in power. The same resurrection power that raised Christ from the dead is in us. And this is the demonstration of the victory over trouble and death and this world. So I implore you, this is a journey, this is a difficult road for all of us, but I want to set before you this morning the confident hope of glory. The confident hope in the grace of Jesus Christ. For the joy set before him, Jesus endured the cross. He obeyed perfectly, even unto death. So that he could achieve what his Father wanted and he could experience the glory on the other side. This is the best I've got to offer you. And I believe it is the most realistic and compelling picture of the truth of our human existence. You can go looking for alternatives. You can go looking for pie in the sky, silver bullet answers, false gospels. Or you can listen to the people who say, What do you get taking it so personally for? This is blind, pitiless, materialist universe. Just get on with it. Don't worry about it so much. Just put up with it. Anything else is ridiculous. I don't believe that that can be true. Because I believe we all know we were made for purpose, for belonging, for love. And this life is not the way it was meant to be. We know that. The only compelling, realistic picture that gives us an answer is the cross of Christ. Let's pray. Lord, we do pray this morning for every person here and online and those we love, the people we know who are doing it tough right now. Lord, sometimes we know life puts us in the absolute pit. And together we call out for those people, Lord. Hear our prayer. Help them, Lord. Provide more than enough of your love and your grace to minister to their broken hearts. Lord, we thank you for the victory through Jesus. We celebrate our confident hope in Jesus. Praise be to the one and only Son of God who delivers us from evil and promises to bring us safely into eternal life. Lord, hear our prayers. Teach us your ways. Help us by the power of your Spirit. We depend on you. In Jesus' name, amen.
To finish our service, I'm just going to ask you to remain seated. We're going to sing a song for you, but feel free to join in as we go along. But this song just speaks of that victory, that the cross was more than enough to give us that victory that Richard talked about. So please join in with us if you want to.
There is no
invite you to stand. We're going to sing just the chorus from Hosanna together just to finish our service off. Please stay for a cuppa. Don't forget, we still will try and go ahead and have our picnic, so feel free to come and join us down at Alexandra Park after the service.